suggested the Everglades Angels for our Share the Plate after learning about their shelter and volunteering at the thrift shop.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Courtney Cannon, and I am here on behalf of Susan Dubbin and Jennifer Ligetti. They asked me to step in, so I'm actually holding two spirits today in this one body.
Today's service reflects upon Soul Matters theme for February, which is the gifts of justice and equity. When we help others in need in our larger community, we create a more equitable living standard for all. Our generosity in helping others enriches our own, lives, bringing us joy and growing in spirit. When we love our neighbors as ourselves, we strengthen our connections with one another, as well as strengthen the fabric of our shared lives in Palm Beach County. So today, we are delighted to hold up the fellowship's history of generosity by highlighting our Share the Plate program, one of the many ways our fellowship reaches out to connect with our neighbors and the world beyond our walls. Let me share with you how our Share the Plate program began. In 2006, our long-term member, Mary Beth Kugler, brought the idea of sharing the plate to the UUFBR board as a way of living our Unitarian Universalist values by promoting justice, equity, and generosity. The program has since evolved over the years, leading to our present-day practice, each Sunday retaining half of the collection for our benefit of the UUFBR, and the other half is shared with a local 501c3 nonprofit organization working to create positive change in our larger community. Marianne Rademacher said, "As we work to create light for others, we naturally light our own way. Through connection and generosity, we build justice and equity, and we also create meaning, light, and joy in our lives." The four organizations you will hear from today, all UUFBR Share the Plate recipients, understand these truths deeply. We are inspired by their efforts and grateful for their commitment to making our world brighter. Their organizations work not just to give to those in need, but to empower the communities they serve. Sometimes they also work to prevent the need for their services, as in the case with our first ever animal-focused Share the Plate recipient, Everglades Angels Dog Rescue, which rescues dogs and rehomes dogs while also educating the public so that fewer dogs are abandoned in the first place. Please welcome our first guest speaker, Denise Guevara from Everglades Angels Dog Rescue. Denise serves as the vice president and treasurer of this all-volunteer organization. I am so pleased she is here today. This is an organization I volunteer with and hold close in my heart. Denise?
Thank you. I'd like to start off with saying thank you very much for allowing us to be a recipient of Share the Plate. So I'd like to start off with saying animal rescue holds immense opposites. It is joyous and rewarding, as well as completely heartbreaking and soul-crushing. Yet we do it, because once you experience both, one fuels the work of the other, and there's no turning back. The biggest underlying theme of rescue is valuing every single life. Every single living being has this immense potential if we only believe in them and give them a chance. Our promises to every animal we rescue is that we provide them with a life worth living, regardless of their age, their breed, or their ailments. On 2/14 EADR, instead of saying Everglades Angels Dog Rescue, we'll be celebrating our 10th anniversary. In a day and age where so many rescues are going under, we've been able to survive. We have rescued over 800 lives, and we currently have over 40 dogs in our care. We are 100% no-kill. We are all volunteers, including the board, who works and is not compensated, but I work 24/7, 7 days a week. I was a teacher, but I retired, and this is what I do 24/7. Upon rescue, our dogs receive the best medical care, vaccinations, microchipping, spay neuters, socialization, and training. We feel if we don't provide our animals with those needs, the cycle just keeps going, because we do not want the future home of our dogs to dump them. So we provide a lot of different services to the families that adopt our dogs. Our dogs have been dumped once, and we don't want them to be dumped again. We also have it where we do follow-ups. We check in on our dogs. We also have adopted our cats. And we make sure that everything is successful in the home. So we provide support. Another thing is we don't allow our dogs to be rehomed. If 5 years down the road something happens and they're not able to care for the animal they adopted from us, we take our animals back. So we, again, once an angel dog, always an angel dog. We survive by donations, grants, our thrift store, which is on Hillsborough and Powerline, as well as monies raised from events. Shelters and rescues are full and operating over capacity. Last year, over 6.5 million dogs and cats entered shelters and rescues. Too many animals and not enough homes. How can you help? You can help because you can become part of the solution. Adopt, rescue, foster. Foster is a big thing. Spay, neuter pets, volunteer, donate. Just some of the ways. On our screen, the puppies you see on the left were abandoned. They were found by a Good Samaritan who was driving on this road by Miami Aviation Park, which is a small airport, and he saw these puppies on the side of the road. He couldn't stop. He reached out, called our number, and we sent some people down there, and thank God we were able to find the puppies. They are since been adopted and doing great. We call them our Christmas puppies. The girl on the right is Kelly Clarkson, who we rescued a few years ago. And she was a healthy black pity. And 2 years ago, she contracted some kind of bacterial infection waiting for a forever home. And she became paralyzed. Well, we didn't say, oh, well, sorry, too bad. We brought her up to the neurologist in Palm Beach, where she spent a month. She's a dog that I think represents all dogs. She loves people, loves other animals. She simply wakes up every morning loving life. She has her wheel, she has her own room, and she's just the happiest dog you could ever meet. And that's just an example of what we do. And I think I had two more pictures, but that pretty much sums up what we do. I have some cards and brochures that I'll probably leave, but if you know anyone that's interested in volunteering, fostering, or even adopting, please give us a call. Thank you very much again. We appreciate it so much.
Thank you very much, Denise. We are delighted to tell you that since 2006, our fellowship has given away 95 $1,000 donations to charity, so a total of 95,000 donated. You can see, yeah, it's pretty amazing. You can see a list of all past recipients posted in Osias Hall. Today, your community services team, which oversees the Share the Plate, has three members, Jennifer, half of me, Susan Dubbin, and Bette. We encourage that all UUFBR members to make suggestions for future recipients, especially if you're actively donating or volunteering with an organization, because that really makes a difference. Our next speaker is Marie Hester from DISC, which stands for Developing Interracial Social Change. We are grateful to DISC for all of their work and want to especially thank them for organizing the Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. celebration each year here in Boca, which several of our UUFBR members and friends attend. Some of you are rocking the shirts I know that you wore. Marie was featured as Hometown Hero in Boca Magazine in 2021 for all of the work she does for our city and residents. She was born and raised here, moved away for college and a long career in human resources in Washington, D.C. She moved back to Pearl City in 2015. Thank you so much for being here, Marie. And we look forward to hearing back.
Good morning. First, I would like to apologize for these shades. I broke my glasses, my clear glasses, but these are glasses because my eyesight is terrible. But my name is Marie Hester, and I'm president of DISC, Developing Interracial Social Change. I was listening to the bio, and everything that I say is true. I was born in Pearl City. My grandfather, Will Demery, was one of the first settlers in Pearl City. And when he purchased that land, I don't even think he had the $5. I looked at the list and it was like, well, wow, when is he going to give the $5 for the property? But it's a large family. The Demeries were a large family. And my grandmother had 14 children, my grandmother. And sometimes I have to pinch myself and say, actually, that was my grandmother. And they settled in Pearl City. This organization, I really never even thought about joining DISC. And when I moved back to Pearl City, I was approached by Marjorie Sullivan, and she invited me to attend a meeting. And when I got there, they asked me to be the secretary. And it was like, I've never wanted to be the secretary of anything. I don't like to take minutes. So I did join, and I found it extremely interesting and the projects that they were doing. Our journey as an organization has been nothing short of remarkable. As I reflect on our accomplishments, I'm reminded of the countless lives we have touched, the challenges we've overcome, and the unwavering commitment that binds this organization together. One of the major accomplishments that we are proud of is the renaming of Glazed Road between Old Dixie and Federal Highway. It was renamed Loris Martin Way. Through collaboration and partnership, pooling our resources and expertise, we amplified our impact, proving that unity truly is strength. Numbers count, y'all. When you show up at those city hall meetings in numbers, they're impressive and you can get some things done. On Saturday, September 23rd, 2023, we unveiled the sign Loris D. Martin Way. This dedicated the street in her name as testament to her legacy. She worked timelessly to preserve the rich history of the Pearl City neighborhood while pushing for progress and growth. She championed causes close to her heart, advocating for better schools, safer streets, and stronger community bonds. She is the first Black bestowed this honor in Boca Raton. It took just this long. I think Loris Martin passed away a little bit over 2 years ago. And she fought until the end. She would stop by my house. If we would invite a journalist to the neighborhood, she would be there in her garage watching. And she said, she would say to me, when you finish, send them to my house. Send them to my house. She was just a strong woman, a real pioneer of the neighborhood. 2023 was an exciting year for DISC. We've been working on the National Register project for the past 2 years. We didn't have any money, but we decided that we would hire Bunny Dearborn, and a gracious member of our organization, DISC, donated money so that we can hire Bunny Dearborn to lead the project, and she's a historian. Each home in Pearl City had to have a exterior survey, landmarks, churches, walls, etc., had to be recorded. On June 10th, 2023, the state historical representative met with the residents of Pearl City to answer any questions that they might have about being on the National Register of Historic Places and how it would affect them. Finally, on December 7th, 2023, the document received its final approval from the Department of Interior. And we had been waiting for that a long, long time. And Bunny had to keep going back and forth about, we had so much information, how to get all of it on it, and the questions that the historical folks in Tallahassee asked her, all of them had to be answered. And another thing that we did was interview pioneers in Pearl City. We've done over 95. We still do interviews from time to time. And those were included too. You have to have stories also when you try to receive this recognition. So finally, Pearl City, from 10th Street to Lincoln Court and Dixie Manor, is now listed on the National Register of Historic Places. And there's still work to be done. There are markers. We even have a wall, and you speak of a wall. The wall is in full tack, in perfect condition, and it needs to be markered. And there are other places in the neighborhood that needs these markers also. So we continue working on that. Another thing that we work on, and we're real proud of, and I can't leave without mentioning it, it is the garden. We created Allen's Place. It is a community garden. And at Allen's Place, we also work with 21 children from the Lois Martin Center in Dixie Manor. And it is so wonderful. Every Wednesday, they come to the garden. They have their own box. We have three master gardeners, and they teach these children how to garden, how to protect your environment. We also have the pollination garden with the butterflies, and that is so important. And it's so important to teach very young children about preserving our environment. Extremely, extremely important. And learning how to produce compost. One of the master gardeners is queen of making compost, and she She comes there and she shows these children how to do it. Could you just imagine? They can go home. They can go home and teach this to their families. We also have John. John comes to the garden, and John is sitting in the audience, and it's so wonderful. He works with the children. I love those songs he makes up. And I love his story. He has a beautiful story he tells about himself and the guitar. And I was so appreciative when one of our dismembers passed away. John created a song, a beautiful, beautiful song. And we did a presentation in the garden on Lynn, and John was one of the primary people. So John, thank you so much. The children in the garden are also a part of Roots and Shoots. And in it, they can choose a seed that they would like to protect. And I think they chose, the okra seed. And they use the main downtown library as a depository. So they're also doing that. And we have a professional artist in the garden, Cherie Binder. And she comes and she works with the kids. And she also teaches them cursive writing. Most children, don't even know how to write cursive. So these are just important things, a few of the important things that this organization is doing. Our success story is not ours alone. It's an invitation for others to join us. We advocate for causes close to our hearts, justice, equality, and compassion. I want to express my deepest gratitude to each volunteer, donor, and supporter. You are the heartbeat of our organization. Please visit us at our website, discofpearlcity.org. I thank you so much.
Thank you, Marie. In a few moments, we'll welcome Victoria Green from Sunflower Creative Arts. Sunflower's mission is to empower children and families to be confident, creative, and compassionate through play, nature, and the arts. And Sunflower began here at UUFBR. It's one of our several nonprofits that found their first home with us. Supporting outside organizations was an intentional ministry of our fellowship from our beginnings in the 1960s. Those early UUFBR folks worked to help fund the Florence Fuller Child Development Center and also set up a tutoring program in UUFBR's first building on Palmetto Park Road in East Boca. While the fellowship movement moved to our present location in the 80s, our buildings are still used regularly by several groups, and Sunflower was one of them for 22 years. Eventually, Sunflower outgrew us and needed a home of their own. So they could be a model learning center and launch more programs in the broader community. We're proud of our history of connection and commitment to social change, and we're honored to hear from Victoria today. Victoria has been involved with Sunflower Creative Arts since 2008 in as many different roles as a parent, an employee, a volunteer, and currently as a board member. As the mother of two former Sunflower kids, she's passionate about giving children and adults the opportunity to learn and grow through play. She's proud that her now teenage sons have stayed involved with Sunflower and are now themselves volunteers. Victoria.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Would you mind going back one slide, please? Many of you may recognize Susan there on that slide. So Susan began the Sunflower Project, like Beth said, right here in this building in 1993. So I want to thank you for inviting me back here today. And that's my son in that picture with Susan. And can you see him up there? There he is, a little guy with the candle. So that's right here out in the playground. So it feels like I was here for so many years with my kids. So feels really special to me to be back here speaking with you and thanking you for your support that you've given to Sunflower throughout the years. I don't know if you have the next slide that I have on my presentation. Nope, that's okay, we'll skip that one. There was one of my kids, but that's okay. So we don't need to see them. So from the beginning, Susan Caruso believed deeply that all children need time for free play every day. Time in nature and exposure to all kinds of process-oriented arts experiences in order to grow up confident, creative, and compassionate. For years, Sunflower grew here at UUFBR, serving local families with play, nature, and arts-based programs for babies, toddlers, preschoolers, and their parents. It's definitely had a big effect on me. As you heard, I've been involved for many years at many levels. Susan also started theater programs for older kids that were based here, including Shakespeare programs, theater outreach programs, and a Jane Goodall Roots and Shoots program. That disc also has Roots and Shoots, a service club for kids. So here in our UU home, Sunflower grew steadily, and in 2003, Sunflower incorporated as a 501c3 nonprofit in order to accept charitable donations and to support a scholarship fund and more community outreach programs. Next slide, please. Eventually, we wanted to serve the broader community in new ways, and we knew we needed a home of our own. So in 2015, with both sadness and excitement and lots of gratitude for the 22 years we had here, we bought and renovated a property in Delray. And if you have not had a chance to visit, it is so beautiful. So I encourage you to visit our new home. This slide shows children on our nature playscape there. In our new location, we're able to serve more than double the number of families with our on-campus programs. Next slide, please. So once we got our footing in Delray, we began to focus on reaching even more children and families, and particularly those from under-resourced communities. In 2018, we launched the Sunflower Play Initiative, a formal way to advocate for play, nature, and the arts for all children. This picture is from the beginning of the Sunflower Play Initiative, also called Build and Play. Today, we conduct 18 build and play sessions a week with about 250 children who range in age from 1 to 14. We work at a number of partner sites, including Village Academy in Delray, the Guatemalan Mayan Center, and Carver Middle School, to name a few. Build and Play is funded solely through grants and donations. Next slide, please. A build and play session takes place in an open space. It could be inside or outside, with an abundance of what we call loose parts. So those are just materials you might find around your house: cardboard, tape, fabric, paper tubes, and other recyclables. Children are invited to create, invent, and build using their imagination. Build and play encourages children to be in control of their play, create something new, work with other children, and trust that their ideas will be taken seriously by our play counselors and other children. We also work with teachers to incorporate more child-initiated creative play into their programs and environments. Next slide, please. Oh, we're missing another one, I guess. That's okay. At Sunflower, we are play advocates. We know that child-initiated creative play, which is characterized by uninterrupted deep engagement, helps kids develop what we call the four C's: creativity, communication, collaboration, and critical thinking skills. That's the one I was looking for. So you can see all the benefits of play and there's a lot going on, and don't forget fun. So if you go back to the previous one, there we go. That's the one I was looking for. So those kids, you can see what they built. I mean, they just were given what I called loose parts, and they, without any instructions from a teacher, that's what they just built. So the children's ideas lead the way in all of our build and play sessions, so they can do whatever they want. Since 2019, we have witnessed the tremendous developmental benefits of build and play as children explore arts materials and loose parts. They create, they invent, they experiment, they share ideas, and they work together. Their faces light up with joy as they fashion costumes for play, they build elevators, they sculpt a gift for a sibling, they dance, they sing, you name it. We see them work through big issues too, such as homelessness and robbery, things that they have personally witnessed and experienced. So I should just have one more slide, and it should be a video. Let's find out. Oh, yeah, I think that's it. And so this video was created to encourage our build and play kids to keep playing during the pandemic. Thank you again for your financial support through the years, and also for giving us a stable home right here for so long. You helped us bloom and grow into who we are today. And I'll just leave you with that video.
Give me fire, give me reason, take me higher. See the champions, take the field down. Unify us, make us feel proud. In the streets our heads are lifting. As we lose our inhibition, celebration, it surrounds us. Every nation, all around us. Sing forever young, singing songs underneath the sun. Let's rejoice in the beautiful game, and together at the end of the day, we all say, when I get older, I will be stronger, they'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. When I get older, I will be stronger, they'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. So wave your flag.
Thank you, Victoria. Our final speaker today is Bill Harper from Boca Helping Hands. After 24 years in the business world, Bill sought a more meaningful experience working in the nonprofit community. His passion was in helping people that struggled to provide for themselves or their family. Bill started at Boca Helping Hands as a volunteer in September 2011, but took a managerial role overseeing all aspects of food recovery and distribution. Now, Bill's passion is twofold, helping volunteers have a meaningful experience in serving others and helping families in need with the necessities of food, education, and healthcare. His desire to serve others has grown stronger as he has served at Boca Helping Hands. Thank you, Bill.
Good morning. I would like to thank UUFBR for choosing Boca Helping Hands to participate in the Shared Plate. You have been longtime supporters of Boca Helping Hands, but I appreciate the opportunity to come and also share with you what we do and how you can continue to help. I brought a short video, if we could play that, and then I'll come back just to kind of talk about how you can get plugged in. Thank you.
Okay. Helping Hands is a community service organization, and we provide a range of services to our neighbors in need, not just here in Boca, but throughout Southern Palm Beach County. So in 1998, we had the humblest of beginnings. In a small local church in their fellowship hall, we started what would essentially be a regular soup kitchen. We're not a soup kitchen anymore. In those 25 years, we have become a much more significant organization, providing much greater support to the needy in our community. The last year really has been a very difficult year for Boca Helping Hands. Everybody's experiencing inflation. The way that has affected us is that a lot of the folks that we serve are already having difficulty making ends meet. Most of the people we serve are working families, but not in jobs that allow them to meet all of their expenses. Has just made making ends meet so much more difficult that we have seen a big increase in the demand for our services, in particular for our feeding services. So at the beginning of last year, we were distributing somewhere around 6,500 bags of groceries every month in our pantry program. By the end of the year, we were distributing 9,000 bags of groceries. You have the demand, and at the same time, we were seeing a reduction in the amount of donated food, which meant that we had to fill that gap by purchasing food. And so it was a big budget challenge for us last year to address the need for that additional food to meet the incremental demand. Throughout Palm Beach County, it is estimated that somewhere around 60,000 of our kids in school, in our local schools, are experiencing food insecurity, which means that they're not sure where their next meal may be coming from. We provide a range of services, including job training programs for people who are trying to enter the workforce for the first time or get a better paying job.
My name is Ronnie Ratliff. I'm from New Brunswick, New Jersey. Boca Helping Hands assisted with actually getting me into a program on a financial end, and also going through job readiness. The job mentoring program for me personally helping me out with just having someone to go to help explain, like, hey, this is a great career path. My long-term goal is to actually start my own business and then be able to give back and hire oncoming students. Working with Ms. Jennifer, which was a great help, you know, coming in and being able to talk to someone and not be judged for it. I just want to thank everybody that helped me out along the way at Boca Helping Hands, because it means a lot to me. I have a direction, and people that donated and people in the program with Boca Helping Hands truly made, you know, a dream come true.
So this is what it's all about. This is the kind of story we hear every day in our job. This is a letter from a grateful client. Dear Boca Helping Hands, it is with gratitude and humility
that I pen this. At 62, I found myself jobless and friendless. I have started working after 3 months of no income. You were strangers and you fed me. You showed me kindness in this cold world, and I will pay it forward. This will be my last pickup as income begins next week. God bless you.
You know, you may not feel as if you're touching lives with the donations that you make, but it's your donation that's allowing a life like this to be touched. So I want to encourage you to continue supporting the work that we do for stories like this.
You gave me a lot of hope.
How do you even follow that? I mean, that just, especially when I hear those stories from our clients, those success stories, this will be my last pickup, she said in her letter, because she no longer needed the services that we provided for her. It's just so moving. And that is what your contributions and your donations of food and your time that you can spend as a volunteer helping others in the community, that's how it works. That's how it all comes together. So just a couple of quick numbers. Pre-COVID, we were seeing in the neighborhood of about 6,000 unduplicated families throughout the course of the year. And we were distributing about 75,000, what we call bags of food, but it was 75,000 visits where they can get non-perishable food, frozen meat, fresh produce, dairy, things like that. That was pre-COVID. And then with COVID, we went up to about 8,000 unduplicated families each year. And we were distributing about almost 85,000 bags or boxes of food, visits. Well, in 2023, we had hoped that we would have gotten back to pre-COVID days, but with the economy the way that it's been, squeezing families, our clients now are not just what you would think a client looks like. They look like me, they look like you, they look like our neighbors. Because if you're renting in this area, rents are going up 30 to 40%. If you own a home that still has a mortgage or even just want to have insurance on your home, your homeowner's insurance is going up 30 to 40%. With fuel prices going up and the food prices, it's like with inflation, let's say 9%, wages were at like 5% increases. So people were really being squeezed. So that's how you, with through your food donations and your monetary contributions, really impact the people in this community. And on behalf of the people that we serve, I really thank you for your continued support. And if you want to get involved, if you want to volunteer, or you know, talk about a monthly giving program, please visit us at bocahelpinghands.org. And again, if you volunteer, I hope to make your experience a very meaningful one. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Please join us in a round of applause for all of our speakers today. We are grateful for your work and honored you joined us to share your inspiring stories. Thank you again.